Yeah, welcome everybody to the science part of today's show. And I will start with the science of invisibility. But as you can surely see me, this is still very much work in progress. So we're working on it. And the first question is, so what is actually invisibility from the perspective of science? It is an optical illusion. It is the same illusions that you get when you're out in the desert and you see in a mirage in the distance that conjures up a picture of water. If you come closer, then the water disappears in thin air and you realize that you have been chasing an illusion. You're all surrounded by optical illusion. It's enough just to look into water. So imagine you look into an aquarium and you see a fish swimming there in the aquarium. But if you move around, you quickly realize that the place where you see the fish is not actually the place where the fish is. Why is that? Where does this come from? Well, you might ask the question, what does it actually mean to see something? So what it means is that all you see is captured by light, is carried by light. And so if you see a fish in the water, then you see the light that comes from the fish, it's scattered by it, and then it gets out of the water, it gets into your eyes, and then you realize the image of the fish. However, on the way from the light moving from the fish to you, it gets refracted. So at the interface between water and air, light rays are no longer straight, but they are tilted and they're bent. And the scientific term for that is refraction. However, you see the image of the fish, assuming that light has always traveled along a straight path. So you're projecting back, and this is where you see the fish, and this is where you see the fish at the wrong place. So what happens in optical materials is that they can bend light, and therefore they can create distortions. I mean, like this image here, if you of a cat looking at fish. And now, what has this to do with invisibility? And so this is what I would like to explain to you about the science of invisibility, the science of the ultimate optical illusion, that is to make something completely disappear. Here are the first scientific papers on the subject, and you don't really have to read them, but if you pay attention to the dates when they have appeared, you notice that they're have all appeared around 10 years ago. Now, 10 years is nothing on the scale of the science of light, on the scale of optics, which is about, in its modern form, 150 years old, and it goes back a long time before, about 1,000 years. So this is a very recent subject, and it has not been part of the mainstream of optics for a considerable time. And that, for example, made it very hard for me to actually publish one of the first papers on the subject, and because it wasn't mainstream science. And what I thought in my journey into invisibility, this started around 2002, and I imagined how can you make something disappear using the rules of how light propagates in a material. And it could be like this. So imagine there's a stream of light rays coming, and they're guided through a material, so they are bent all the way, and this is indicated in this picture by the different shades of gray. They visualize different speeds of light where light is induced to bend. And imagine you can create a situation like this, that a bundle of light rays moves through the material, and then it gets recombined in the other end as if nothing has happened. Now, if you would put something in the middle, then this something would never be touched by light, and therefore you wouldn't see it. But you also wouldn't see that you don't see it, so because the light always goes around it and therefore hides it completely. And now, the task is, how do you design this? How do you find a material? How do you find the properties of material that does exactly that? And the inspiration for me came from another connection between optics and something else, and that is the physics of space. So what happens in curved space, and we know from Albert Einstein that gravity can be understood as a curvature of space. So if you have an object like the sun that is exerting gravity, then what it does, it curves space, but it while curving space, it also sends light around the object that has created the curvature of space. So, for example, if you watch the sun, then you could see that the images of stars are changed by the sun. You could see this very well at the solar eclipse. And now, so this connection between the physics of the very large, of space, curved, and optics, this allows you to design cloaking devices. How? Well, this is shown in these two diagrams. So if you pay attention to them, on the what you see on the right-hand side, this is what happens in physical reality. So this is, it's called physical space. And what you see on the left-hand side, this is the illusion the material is creating for you. So the first trick is to use the tools of transforming space, that is assuming that what your material does is a transformation of space. So each point in physical space is mapped to a point in virtual space. In doing so, of course, pictures are changed. So the fish you see on the right-hand side, their images are distorted in the way the medium acts on them. And one of these fish has actually disappeared. How do you make this possible? Because you assume you surround the fish by some region in space, in physical space, and in virtual space, this region has become a single point. Now, a single point is invisible, and hence, the object, the fish, has disappeared. So this is invisibility by demagnification, making something infinitely small. How is that connected to the bending of light? Well, you see this also from this picture, because the lines in this map of space, they are given by light rays. So the light rays in physical space are bent by the material. However, in the illusion, they are straight, because that's what you assume to see. So you always assume that the light rays are straight. And hence, you have a straight line in the virtual space. So this shows you how you can guide light around an object and to make it disappear, but also make the act of invisibility itself invisible. Now, this is very hard to do in practice, and it really has not been demonstrated in its full range in optics. There have been a demonstration for microwaves, but there have been a couple of experiments on something related to this. And this is not to make something disappear, but to turn a round object flat, like in this picture again, using the example of fish, you turn a fugu into a flat fish. And this is much easier to do in practice, and in such a way that I want to show you a little video of an experiment where this has been done, not with fish, no fish has been harmed in this research, but with a paperclip. So let's go to the lab and see what's happening there. These two gentlemen, they are the researchers, Chang Zhuang from the University of Birmingham and his colleague, and this is the device. So let me explain what you see in the picture. So the crystal that you see, this is the cloaking device. So this is, it's a crystal that distorts an optical image. Then comes the paperclip behind that. And then the golden part, this is simply part of a mirror. So what is now going to happen is that you're looking at an image, it's going to be a panda in that demonstration, and reflected at this mirror. And then another aspect of this, you have to choose the right polarization of light. So light carries a polarization. Therefore, there's a polarization filter that you can vary. So you look for the right or the wrong polarization at the image of the panda in the mirror. Without the cloaking device, you wouldn't actually see this clearly because the paper clip would block your field of view. But with the cloaking device, you should see the image of the panda. So let's see whether this actually happens in practice. So you see the first thing, this is a polarization filter. So the researcher is looking through the polarization filter at the image. You see it's blocked. And then, with the right polarization, it has disappeared. So this is a demonstration of making a paperclip invisible. Sometimes you wish to make bureaucracy invisible that way as well. But why stopping with optics? So you could also explore other kinds of waves. So for example, sound waves. And this is an image from research on cloaking of sound waves. So the person holds a little cloaking device in its hand. It doesn't work on light. I mean, you clearly see this, for example. But it works for sound waves in water. That's interesting to the Navy, who want to hide large objects, submarines, from detection by sonar. So the experiment was this. So you put in a pool of water an object that scatters ultrasound, and you scan the image with a hydrophone. And then you put this cloaking device around it, and then you see that the sound is guided around it, and so such that the object has disappeared. But why would you stop there? So you could go further. So you could cloak other kind of waves on a gigantic scale, and these are earthquakes. Earthquakes are just waves. They are like sound waves, very violent ones, and they are the sound of the Earth. So you could, in principle, use the same techniques, the same ideas as for cloaking of light or sound waves, ordinary sound waves, to also protect buildings, like bridges, from the impact of earthquakes. And this has been demonstrated in a serious scientific paper, and it also involved some serious civil engineering for that. And it's done by drilling holes in the ground. So the material that reflects the equivalent of an earthquake was created by drilling holes on a regular basis on the ground. And then the digger you see in the picture was shaking the ground at the right frequency of an earthquake. And indeed, what they could, in the experiment, determine is that the wave was indeed reflected from it. So there is a way to control waves on all scales, be it light waves, sound waves, or even earthquakes, perhaps, and not only control to make an undesirable wave disappears, but what you could also imagine, like in this arena here, that you could improve the acoustics of places by the right transformations of acoustical space in that respect. What limits research in this field is it's not the materials, it's the limits in the minds, it's the imagination. Following a saying of Albert Einstein that imagination is more important than knowledge, because knowledge is always limited to what you now know and understand, whereas imagination embraces the entire world and everything that there ever will be to know and to understand. Thank you very much.